Tonight we're going to be covering a fair bit of ground actually, and so you bear with me. It's not been an easy presentation to prepare at all actually, and it's taken me quite some time and looking at some things which are not quite pleasant to look at times. But we're going to go through it, and the talk is Exposing the Fruit of Evolution. It's part two, and obviously there was a part one, and probably some of you, and I guess definitely some of you weren't here for the first part. So what I'm going to do is just very briefly go through the first part, which was exposing the roots of evolution. And but before we do that, I always do this right at the beginning, a definition of evolution, so we know we're batting on the same wicket. The Oxford English Dictionary says it's the origination of living things by development from earlier forms, not by special creation. And my understanding is adaptation, natural selection are scientific principles, testable, but evolution is not. Adaptation, for example, people have quoted things like peppered moths or Darwin's finch beaks or something like that. But evolution, as I mentioned in the first part, I traced it right through as a philosophical route, and certainly Sir Karl Popper referred to it as a metaphysical research program. So Karl Popper, by the way, was a very, very well-known leading philosopher, an Austrian chap. So let's just recap on the first part of the talk I did a few weeks ago, which was exposing the roots of evolution. And I referred to Charles Darwin's sixth edition of Origin of Species in 1888. And he lists in the preface there about others that had gone before him. You see, the thing was that Charles Darwin, when he wrote his original in 1859, others had already been thinking about and writing about and lecturing about evolutionary ideas before him. But I guess there was pressure on him, so when he came to the sixth edition, he gave credit where credit was due. So he listed about 22 people before him, including Aristotle, he mentions there, and the footnotes also connected with Empedocles. So there he says, passing over the allusions to the subject in classical writers. Well, last time I spoke, I made a beeline for the classical writers and tracing back something of the ancient philosophy of evolution a long time before Charles Darwin. So we went, and it was quite a shock to some people, about Brahmin thinking, philosophical ideas in India, some 3,000 years or so before Charles Darwin. And the quotation here from Mahabharata, which says, these, that is the creative processes, this is the whole process of the universe and everything else coming to being, in succession acquire the attributes of the immediately preceding ones from which they have originated. Each has not only its own special attribute, but each succeeding one has the attributes of all the previous ones. I showed a number of references of some of the Hindu writings, but if you want to look at it in more detail, because I'm only whizzing through this, then please have a look on Edinburgh Creation website and you'll see the full talk. Then I passed through from the evidence linking from the Hindu Brahmins, Pythagoras, who was influenced by Egyptians, Babylonians and others, including the Brahmins, and many of his ideas came through the Brahmin understanding. A form of pantheistic evolution. They had an understanding of reincarnation, but which is quite different because obviously the soul leaves a body and comes back into another creature or so on. But they had this upward tree of life, as I spoke about last time, which from the beginning was this evolving process. On the other hand, a contemporary of Pythagoras was Thales, who he branched out instead of pantheistic, meaning God is the universe, is a consciousness and everything. Thales instead was a naturalistic evolutionist. He said basically everything came through entirely natural processes, and there were a whole lot of people like Democritus and Epicurus and others that came through that line. I went on to Plato in Timaeus. He said these are the principles on which living creatures change and have changed into one another, the transformation depending on the loss or gain of understanding or folly. Well, that was not quite the understanding we have today, but nevertheless he was talking about transformation of creatures from a lower to a higher form. And then there was Aristotle, more of a fixed understanding. But Plato and Aristotle, their understanding was debated and worked through right through the Middle Ages, through to the Enlightenment time. Quotation from Voltaire, when I first read Plato and came upon this gradation of beings which rises from the lightest atom to the supreme being, I was struck with admiration. Big debate in France and in Britain and other parts of Europe. I mentioned Lord Monboddo, James Burnett, who was here in Edinburgh, and he spoke about, even back in 1768 in fact, he spoke about the orangutan being as an animal betwixt a monkey and a man, and he spoke about almost anticipating Haeckel's recapitulation theory in the womb. And then he had an influence on Erasmus Darwin. Both of them were Freemasons at the oldest Masonic Lodge here in Edinburgh. And Erasmus Darwin wrote two books, Zoonomia and Temple of Nature, which had a big influence on a lot of people in the Enlightenment period, and again were free runners for his grandson, Charles Darwin. Interestingly enough, Charles Darwin doesn't give credit to either Lord Monboddo or Erasmus Darwin, probably because of some of their spiritual beliefs they had with it too. Well, let's now move on to the talk we're addressing this evening. The Fruits of Evolution, Part 2, that's what we're looking at. And we're looking at particularly three aspects. And in fact, I think probably I could have done another talk on the third one, the sexual revolution, but we'll try our best. Eugenics, ethnic cleansing, and the sexual revolution. So let's move, first of all, to eugenics. And what is eugenics? Well, it basically means that it's well-being, translated eugenes, it's well-being or well-offspring, trying to produce well or good offspring. And interesting enough, we had this quite recently, I think it was last week or a couple of weeks ago, in the Independent. I don't know whether you were following all the furore caused at the time by something which Dr. James Watson, he was one of the chaps that cracked DNA code back in the 50s with Crick, and he was saying, basically, this is summed up, this is the Independent, Africans are less intelligent than Westerners, says DNA pioneer. And it says at the bottom there, fury over scientist theory, all our social policies are based on the fact that their intelligence is the same as ours, whereas all the testing says not really. Now that caused a big stink, and in fact I think he was due to speak here in Edinburgh, but it was cancelled because of people who were very upset about what they thought were racist remarks and so on, and even harbouring back to the time of eugenics, which is going to be our main subject or tonight. Interesting enough, Dr. Crick, his colleague in the DNA work back in the 50s, he said in 1978, no newborn infant should be declared human until it has passed certain tests regarding its genetic endowment, and that if it fails these tests, it forfeits its right to live. Interesting enough, it's actually not new. Maybe the complexity of DNA and genetic understanding is, but the philosophy is not. Now here's a quotation straight from Plato's Republic. We must, if we are to be consistent, and if we're to have a real pedigree herd, make the best of our men with the best of our women as often as possible, and the inferior men with the inferior women as seldom as possible, and bring up only the offspring of the best. And no one but the rulers must know what is happening, if we are to avoid dissension in our guardian herd. And we shall have to devise an ingenious system of drawing lots, so that our inferior guardians can, at each mating festival, blame the lot and not the rulers. Our rulers will have to employ a great deal of fiction and deceit for the benefit of their subjects. Each generation of children will be taken by officers appointed for the purpose, who may be men or women or both, for men and women will, of course, be equally eligible for office. These officers will take the children of the better guardians to a nursery and put them in charge of nurses living in a separate part of the city, obviously when they're grown up, not as babies. The children of the inferior guardians and any defective offspring of the others will be quietly and secretly disposed of. They must be, if we are to keep our guardian stock pure. And as I said, that was from Plato's Republic, 375 BC. And as I mentioned before, Plato was a big influence in evolutionary thinking. And here we have something of his, really the forerunner, foreshadowing the whole thing about eugenics.